As I've shared, I've been working on getting our information out more, marketing it, so to speak. One thing I found is that a lot of people get their news, their medical news, from Medical News Today. So I started to look at that, and it actually reminded me I need to get some information out there about vitamin D, the D2D study. Basically, what they're finding, it was a randomized clinical trial that was just reported in the New England Journal on June 7th, using a couple of, a little over 2,000 individuals to see if they, if giving them vitamin D actually prevented development of type 2 diabetes. It looked like it didn't. Why was I looking in Medical News Today? Again, I'm trying to get our information out there. We peaked recently at 40,000 views in a day. That's great, but it's not nearly enough compared to the tides of people that are still continuing to die from heart attack, die from stroke, and become permanently disabled from stroke every few minutes. So again, we'll continue to push in that area. But right now, let's get a little bit deeper in terms of the D2D study. I noticed it was funded by the National Institute of Diabetes and Digestive and Kidney Diseases. So I went to clinicaltrials.gov. Anything that's funded by the feds, and the vast majority of things are these days, you can get some good information. You can look at study details, the participants, what kind of study model. You can get look at the tabular view. You get a lot more information, again, about stuff that's not reported yet. But it's really bad on the reporting side. As you saw in this last tab here, no results posted. Well, heck. Estimated study completion, May 2021. Maybe that's true, but again, this study came out in New England Journal June 7th, 2019. Here's actually an editorial on that that study. Let me see if I can move that over without messing up my graphics here. It's the D2D, No Defense Against Diabetes. Basically, what they're saying is they looked at vitamin D on folks. They're wanting to give a little bit of background. Here's the table one. It's the their view, the standard view of vitamin D levels and health. Those still haven't changed despite a huge amount of research indicating that they probably should. So here it is, yes, in the New England Journal, and I'm disagreeing with it. Where? You'll see in a minute. Less than 12 milligrams deficiency in rickets, yes, of course, and osteomalacia, of course. 12 to 20 insufficient for bone and overall health, I would agree. 20 to 50 is sufficient? Not really. Maybe getting 40 and above is probably okay. 50 and greater is risk of adverse health effects? I would not agree with that. Again, I've reviewed the research, and I recommend 60 to 80. I had a patient that came in recently with a number way over 100. Her name is Julie. She agreed to share her story. She was taking like 50,000 units, I believe, a day for a few weeks. We got her back down to good levels, and again, so anytime people say, well, why do you keep talking about both sides? Why do you keep providing balance? That's why. You can get too much of a good thing. And a lot of people see that vitamin D3 is a good thing, but you can get too much. And a lot of that's going on. But this is an interesting editorial. Basically, what they did was they started out, like all of these studies on vitamin D, talking about the background of information showing that it is healthy for not only just bones. Vitamin D has an impact on calcium levels, has an impact on kidney health, has an impact, at least according to observational studies, even on type 2 diabetes. So they've started to do some, there are several randomized clinical trials which have been conducted to look at that. The first one just came out. It's called the D2D, Now, what did that study look like? 2,423 participants, they had to meet at least two of three criteria for prediabetes: an impaired fasting glucose level. So usually that's going to mean, in most cases, 100 or above. To me, 90 or above. But again, to most folks, 100 or above. Impaired glucose tolerance. So that means looking at an OGTT. And a glycated hemoglobin level of 5.7 to 6.4. If they had two of those, they were randomly assigned to get 4,000 international units of vitamin D3 or a placebo. They were still eligible, even if they were taking vitamin D, up to 1,000 units daily. And I get a ton of people that tell me coming in, yes, I take vitamin D3, and then I find out they were taking 1,000 units. My reaction is the same as the study design here. Up to 1,000 units a day is just not significant. So, what did they find in terms of vitamin D levels coming into the study? Most of them had what they would consider a vitamin D level that was, it was over 20s. It was 28 per milliliter. And 73% had at least 20 nanograms per milliliter, or 70 nanomoles per liter or 50 nanomoles per liter. So again, these folks had what would the standard of saying 20 or above, they had that much. So what did they do with the trial? Again, they gave one group, the study group, 4,000 units a day. The control group, placebo. What did they find? No impact in terms of development of type 2 diabetes. How did they diagnose it? That's maybe another issue for another time. Important, but not covered in this this article. Now, am I stopping my vitamin D3? Am I stopping a recommendation to take vitamin D3? No. Why? Again, this is one study, not a huge study. It is a randomized clinical trial, which, again, is usually pretty strong. But I'm not stopping. And so why? Here are a couple of things on the other side of that argument. First of all, it was a hazard ratio of 0.88. So what does that mean? Bottom line is it doesn't rule out a modest benefit from vitamin D3. Was there a earth-shaking benefit that we expected from the beginning? No. You know, it's just like what I've said from day one and will continue to say. You can't take vitamin D3, and never did, none of us ever said, well, some do. You can't supplement your way out of a bad lifestyle. So none of these supplementation activities are going to have an impact like an appropriate BMI or fat mass. None of these are going to have an impact like appropriate diet in terms of carbs. Again, just not in the same ballpark. So that's one issue. There still could be a modest benefit, and in the beginning, we've always thought maybe it's a modest benefit. Observational trials have shown associations. However, again, what they're looking at, here's the biggest thing. They're looking at people that had levels in the 20s. They didn't look at people with a true vitamin D deficiency. So again, there very well may be a much stronger association if you have a complete vitamin D3 deficiency. Now, how important is that, and how practical is that? In the U.S., that's probably not a practical issue, even though it's reasonable and makes a lot of sense. Why is it not practical? Because most people don't have, in the U.S. anyway, don't have vitamin D levels lower than 20. Now, where do you see that if you do? Well, in the U.S., it's with vitamin D insufficiency, you see it more in older age, in African Americans, Asians, Hispanics, any people of color, obesity, and other diseases. So, in summary, it was a good trial. I would agree with that. It was well conducted, randomized, clinical trial. Does it mean that there's not a strong preventive effect for vitamin D3 and going from insulin resistance up to diabetes? It might. I think that that's certainly a possibility. Does it mean that we shouldn't be taking vitamin D3? No, not at all. I'll get a little bit deeper into the actual study itself on another video. Thanks for your interest if you've made it this far. This is just a quick video plugging a series that I did recently on exogenous ketones. This is from Dr. Annette Bosworth. I've seen a few of her videos, and recently I've really gotten more interested. One thing that I had a question about, though, is she said multiple times that if you take exogenous ketones, it will stimulate your mitochondria to start burning ketones and get you into ketosis earlier and make it easier for your body to get into ketosis. Let's put that aside I'll go ahead and do the spoiler. I looked it up. I can't find significant scientific evidence that that's truly the case. Anyhow, I got some of it and I'm trying it. I do this kind of stuff. If you look at some other YouTubers like Ken Berry, he would say, oh, these things are terrible. And here's his major focus, and it's always the focus that I've had until recently, and that is the mistaken assumption that you can take exogenous ketones and still eat your normal diet with a lot of carbs, and it's going to do you do some good for you. I know that a lot of people do that, and to me, that's just plain dumb. But so that's why I never had any interest in exogenous ketones until, again, listening more to Dr. Boz and hearing her say multiple times that these do help prepare you. Now, I will say this. She is way deep into the keto lifestyle, and I do respect a lot of the stuff that I've heard from her. That's why I'm trying them. Again, I did a video on this series, or a series of videos on this specific topic. Just Google Ford Brewer and exogenous ketones. Thanks.